always young. So therefore, that is what you rely on. Exactly the same with a healer. A healer can heal others, when in actual fact they can be dying themselves. The power that is used is not a power that is taken from them, nor can they use it for their own self. It's a power that comes to them. And they can be used as a channel, even though you are dying. And then there's the great R.J. Lees, who at 92, when he was passing away, went into trance on his deathbed, and he was dying, and the spirit came through the guides and gave their farewell to the family and said that they would not be seen again in this world. They were going with their father into the next, and they would not hear from the father either. He had further work to do, and that happened. But at 92, still went into trance, yet he was dying. So we must know these things, try to understand them, because then you will begin to realize the importance of being a spiritualist, and especially if you have some work to do, and if you are dedicated enough to want to be a part of it, so that you can learn. Now, if you do, the first thing to remember is that the whole of development is to spiritualize oneself. That is the whole basis of your leadership, because you will move because of your spirituality, from one level to another. So it is the development of your inner self that is important. Gifts. Well, let us start right at the bottom. Because psychic gifts can be summarized as follows. Psychometry, which we're going to show you tonight, and I have forgotten something. Tom, in the car you'll find a little box. And in the box, you'll find a very small little box. There are a pair of goggles, and there's also a crystal in the shape of an egg. Yes. I'm going to show you how we used to train years ago, and we're going to try it out again tonight. To show you the sort of things that that draw the line between psychic gifts and gifts of the spirit. And this is the only way you will learn, and you will realize how they have been, misunderstood by people that have found that they can do certain things under certain conditions and call it mediumship. I want to show you that that is not so. So therefore, what we want to do is to learn that spiritual gifts are vital, they're important, that they're important to you. If you're born with these gifts, you've got to use them. If you don't, then, ladies and gentlemen, you are going to regret it when you pass over. In fact, you'll find you'll be forced into the situation time and time again. Okay? Thank you very much. Years ago, there was a man named Kilmer who made Kilmer screens. And these were used by mediums. This is one of the very original of Kilmer screens, and I think there are only about three now left in the country. And these were used by my mother, they were used by her aunt, and they were used by her uncle, so they have had a lot of use by very first-class mediums. These are intended that you wear them. They are infrared glass, they are the red tinted glass, and you were trained with these to see the aura. Now you put them on, and under these conditions you won't see anything at all. But with use, you find that it does help. In other words, it's very much like taking a photograph of something that's got nothing there, and using a particular sort of infrared camera of where you begin to tap in onto other vibrations that can be used only by people that have the gift and the power. And if you have, then these can definitely help you. But they will only help you psychically. Take them away and you've still got to develop it. What it does teach you is how you can see things that you can't normally see with the normal vision. Everything looks purple, which is that particular ray that is used on that level. And when we were trained in a room that had no windows, and there was always a very small red light, very small indeed, up in the roof there, and people sat in a particular position, and a person concentrating on them would very often, you put these on in this manner, and after a while of concentration, you begin to see various colors coming in. Now you don't get them straight away, you have to be very patient, and you have to learn. In other words, it's a guide, it's a help to encourage. Now, because they were, I think that in actual fact, because the man passed away, Kilner himself, who was a scientist who encouraged those books written about the kidney stones, he brought it about. Today they've advanced even beyond this, of course. Now they have a machine which has been scientifically tested. And this is now in France. It not only shows the aura, but it also measures the aura. And it can measure you when you are in the state of normal to the state of being supernormal. And this is why we know now what we've been trying to tell people for a very long time, that when you are sitting correctly and properly, there are lights coming from you that normally you can't see if you are just a reader of an aura. You have to go into the spiritual side of it. And now this machine is able to detect these very faint vibrations and begin to show that as you go into a state of concentration onto the higher level, and that you are visited, your mind is beginning to tune in onto other levels, that this is able to show you how it moves this sort of pendulum and various things into various distances. Now, we know by that that what we'd heard with regard to St. Francis and the Buddha, and also Jesus himself, when they were able to see him at night time, when they were in the state of prayer, that there came a light around them. You got it with Moses when he came down from the mountain, and they saw a ray around him. That ray is the one we're talking about. It's the ray of spiritual growth. And this is a very real thing. And once we have learned to understand that, then we begin to realize how this can be used. And it is used, of course, in absent healing. It's used by healers when they project their thoughts in prayer to people that are away from them. So it isn't a question that mediums just say it. We are able to prove it. Now, although the evidence of interpretation is at the moment with mediums, there will come a time when science will be able to prove that mediums are interpreting these things correctly. Astrology also proves it, because we are able, by holding a child, for example, forecast and various things about their life. With the astrologer will look for things and be able to tell you the certain things that can happen in this person's life. We can give a character reading. We can also predict. And it can be proven by astrologers. So therefore, everything that is happening in spiritualism can be proven. And science doesn't, whatever they do, it does not contradict anything that we have said over the thousands of years. They're proving that we are correct. And we have said what we've always said, that the whole of everything in your life comes with you at birth. And that everything that is going to happen to you is known. And that there are vibrations around you that link you with the worlds that are around us, our planetary system, our solar system. Now, with research, it has been proven. Rays of which you come with into this world that belong to certain planets the mediums have been able, through their clairvoyance, been able to say they've seen this. Now astrologers are able to prove it. They're able to prove, for example, that certain vibrations on the piano, on notes, are exactly the same as a color vibration. The people that have studied it can tell you. They tie up identically. So therefore, each has a meaning. And many people make a great mistake when they try to interpret what they see too quickly before they check it. The great people check it. My mother believed in palmistry. She was a great believer in palmistry. And after every sitting she gave, she always asked to see the hand of the person that she had given the sitting to. And I have today all her manuscripts on various things that over the years, the many people that she had seen, very well-known people, and she'd taken, given them their sitting, she'd noticed there's things in their hands that she was able to prove, brought about who they were and what they were. Now this is what these great mediums did. They didn't just sort of say it with little knowledge, they studied it. And because they did, that's what made them great. They always checked and double-checked. And so therefore we have knowledge today of which they didn't have in the past. And if only people would go by knowledge and learn more, so that they've got knowledge there, they would advance much more quickly with their mediumship. Because you know what you're dealing with. And you'll find it is something that once you've studied it, makes not only sense, but it tells you again and again and again and again that there is a divine law. And that is the important thing. When everyone says, I don't believe in a God, if you're going to talk about what you think God is, isn't going to be the answer. You've got to prove it. And therefore, I believe that in Spiritism we can, if we do it properly, if we check, if we make sense of everything, and don't talk for the sake of talking. Always discover what it is. Now in colour, people try to interpret their own colour because they think, in actual fact, they're being clever. They say certain things, because I see it, I'm telling you, that it's to do with your health. I've heard it so often. And I know they're wrong, ladies and gentlemen. Because I've proven it, tested it, and I know what colours mean. Because I've made a study of it. It happens to be something I'm very interested in. And I believe that what we have to do is to understand it. And realise that you are made up of light. And light is made up of the spectrum of colour of vibration. And each one is linked with the universe itself. Now when you develop certain colours, you are supposed to develop. If you are developing them correctly, then you will develop this extra sense, because there will be spiritual powers that will work with you on spiritual levels. And that means that around you is this light that you are creating by your development. Now, isn't it going to be much better for us as spiritualists to be able to bring light to the world? Surely that's what our job is. And it is to be able to feel that you have developed this power. And where you go, people feel it. I like it when people say to me, you know, when you come, we feel so much happier. And when you leave something behind. Now that's more to me than anything else, because you can go to places and you know you haven't touched it at all. You come away feeling whether you've been a waste of time. In others, you reach it, you're with the people, there is something that glows, there's something you know that you've reached. And although you go away, you know you've left something. You know that instinctively. And when you meet them, it all comes back, because you know that you've reached something. And that's what mediums are supposed to do. That is what you're supposed to do. If you're developing, not just sitting in a class and just wanting to be a medium, it's to develop something. It is to be of use somewhere. It's to be able to feel that you can sit still and that you can rise with these beautiful colours, with these beautiful lights, with a power, and that in that power can come a visitor from the higher realm and use you in some way. You may not know what it is. It doesn't matter. You don't need to know. Let the spirit people do it. They know what they're doing. I always have faith and belief and trust. Therefore, always remember that mediumship is a treasured gift. If reincarnation is true, I'm not telling you whether I'm telling you I believe it, but I'm not telling you I can prove it. I believe it because it makes sense to me. Nevertheless, if you come back and you come back and you come back, I don't want to come into this world again unless I can be a medium. I love to hear singers, I'd love to be a singer, but if I had my choice of any gift, no matter what it is, the one gift that I would still take is the gift of knowing that there is a purpose to life. I've studied music, and you'll never believe it, in actual fact I had singing lessons. And I used to be a voice of comedy, incredible, isn't it? And when you hear me now, it's actually awful. But nevertheless, I did. And I thought it was lovely. And I used to sing in the choir and sing all the solo parts. And my voice never broke for a long time. But it did break. I mean, I thought it was dreadful. But even though I'd love to be an opera singer, or I'd love to be one of the famous pianists, I'd love to play, I'd love to do all those things, I would still sacrifice all that just to be able to know that I was the contact with the other. Because I believe that that is the greatest gift that anyone can have. And God isn't going to give you that gift unless you can work for it, you can earn it, and that you can treasure it. It is, to me, the diamond. It has to be polished. You have to have its many facets. But it is the most treasured stone. It's precious. When you are sitting, that's what you have to consider. You will have to be patient. Take the long way round, not the easy way through. Always the long way round. And you'll find if you will do, then ladies and gentlemen, you'll never regret it. You'll have hardship. You'll have difficulties. You'll make enemies. But you have a host of friends. And many of these friends are not of this world, but they are of the higher world. When you go across to that world, you'll find that the people that really love you most are not always your own personal family, but people that are of your soul, linked with that soul. And that is something very precious. Now you just think about it. And remember, you're touching something that's deeply spiritual and tremendously, to my mind, divine. Now although I've shown you these, it is only an aid. And what is it? This was my great-grandmother's. It's very old. That's why it's like a pear. I suppose in those days they probably couldn't get them so right. This is a very, very old one, and it was my grandmother's, my great-grandmother's. And it was passed on to the family right the way down, and of course my mother obviously left it to me to use correctly and never to use it only for spiritual purposes. We developed our mediumship with this particular crystal. Now you're going to say, but isn't that used for fortune telling? Ladies and gentlemen, it was never intended for fortune telling. Never intended at all. It's intended only a means of concentration. This lovely sort of crystal here will only project, it becomes a photograph, a mirror. And what you're sensing that you would normally sense here, you sense in the crystal. And all it does, it holds your thoughts and holds your attention to what you're doing. That is why we mediums, many of us, can take three contacts at the same time and keep going back to the contact, because you're holding your concentration. And you can also go back to a contact when you have developed correctly, and if you have been to a person, and you can, in actual fact, go back to a contact that you made with a person 10, 20, 30, 40 years before. And you can go right to the spot of where your contact broke away. And then you can continue from then on. But you can't do it unless you're properly trained. And therefore you need to be taught to concentrate. So that's what, first of all, I'm going to show you what my mother used to make me do. You see, psychometry is a very remarkable gift. But psychometry can only tell you some things that have happened. It can't tell you anything that's going to happen. You cannot prophesy with a crystal. You can only bring it up to now. You need a medium without the crystal to go into the future. The crystal cannot tell you anything to come. It can only tell you exactly what's happened. So supposing someone is missing, a psychometrist can tell you something about what has happened as they passed. With a crystal, you can very often see the place of where it has happened, because it becomes a mirror of the thoughts that you're receiving and can create a picture through the concentration by mirroring it into the crystal. And so I was trained by my mother through psychometry with the crystal. And that is why many of our mediums who give psychometrical readings, like the great Claire, Mrs. Canuck, who I think I told you about, she was trained exactly the same way through the crystal, because she was trained in the portraits. And therefore, she had to go through the same as we did. We all had to go through the same way. She was trained at the same church where I belong, and I'm the president's day. And we had to, through psychometry, hold an article, put the crystal on it, close it away, concentrate onto the article through the crystal, and thus give your whole contact. It was written down, and then afterwards it was all gone through, and everything we had got then had to be right. If you didn't, you had to go through it again till you got it right. What is it for? To teach you to be sensitive, and teach you also concentration. And that's the most difficult thing of all your development. Because, ladies and gentlemen, you know just as well as I do, when you are sitting, and you're sitting in a circle, or you're giving it, you're there, and you're getting something, or aren't you thankful when somebody says yes? You are. Now, you've got to be taught, ladies and gentlemen, to hold that concentration. And when someone says no, have you noticed how they go to pieces? And if you get two no's, if you get three no's, you pretty well had it. And you know it. Because all at once, you go right down. Now, with proper training, that's when you dig your toes in. You get back onto your first thing and go through it again to see where you went wrong. That is holding the link, not allowing anyone to put you off. And it is something that when you are developing, you've got to learn. And realize your development is not by having all the yeses. Your best development is when you start off with all no's. Because it's making you work. And you've got to keep control of your emotions and control of everything else. So that when you are saying, oh, well, we must help, you are not helping by saying yes if it should be no. You are doing more harm to the medium in the early stages, because they will think they're right when they're wrong. By putting them right, that's really getting them right. So these are things we have to learn. So psychometry is a psychic gift. not a spiritual gift, it's a psychic one. Because we can train every one of you that is here now, even though you might have, you think, no spiritual gifts, we can train you to be a psychologist. I can train you within a week of how to use a crystal. But can't tell your fortune. Because telling fortunes, I can assure you, is only telling you what you want to know. Don't ever let me catch one person as a medium giving fortunes, because that is an insult to what mediumship and real crystal gazing, what we call, is all about. It has to be used correctly and properly, scientifically. Mediumship is a science, and we have to use it in the proper manner. Therefore, you use it in the proper manner. I'm not telling you to do it, because you want a teacher that knows it to teach you that, not just someone that just lets you get away with it. That's not true. You must put it in its rightful place. And what I'm saying to you is, when somebody comes and says, I'm going to tell you a fortune, or there's a man coming in your life, forget it. You know? And don't start sort of asking someone, am I going to get a move? And they say, oh yes, you're going to have a number 3 on a door. Forget that. Because they can't see that. That isn't the way it's done. They can't tell you the future. It's a psychic gift. It can only tell you what you want. And they're merely tapping your mind and telling you what you want them to tell you. That's what that is. Nothing to do with the spiritual. It's nothing to do with being genuinely sane. It's a lot of people that know a lot of rattle, and they rattle up the same things. We came to you and said to you, you either want a flat, madam, or you want a bungalow. Nearly everybody says yes. And the majority of people, if you give them a sitting, and you say to the wife, see you later on having some lovely little place somewhere, nearly everyone said, you know, they tell me exactly what I wanted. But if you go to 9 people out of every 10, that's exactly what they want. They're not telling you anything that's unusual. They're telling you what is a perfect thing that everybody else wants to know. And they get away with it. Because you don't start using your common sense. Now, what is important is to put the gifts in the proper place. A tarot reader is a psychic gift. It has nothing to do with the mediumship gift. It proves nothing, except that you are psychic, and that you can tell people things. The crystal gazer is the same. The psychometrist is the same. Numerology and things of that sort are all sciences of the psychic. Therefore, what we have to understand is that these things are there. For example, an astrologer, though it is a science, to be a good astrologer, you develop this awareness. You develop the psychic gift. Then there comes a line of demarcation, because flower clairsentience is not a psychic gift. Flower clairsentience is a spiritual gift, because through flowers you can be trained that only mediums can do it. A psychometrist cannot really give you flower clairsentence. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I am a psychometrist, but I cannot give you a flower service. Absolutely hopeless to me. I cannot do it. It isn't my gift at all. I was never trained that way, and I can't possibly ever do it. Now, there are marvelous flower clairs. It's a spiritual gift. It's a gift. So what we do now to get it right is we train you as a psychometrist. And then to lead you on, we train you as a flower psychometrist or a flower clairsentence, because that teaches you how to link with the spiritual side of something. See the difference now we're learning, which we didn't know in the past. It's only through experience that we're now learning. So you see, we didn't know it all in the past. We only knew the past. But now, through experience, watching mediums working ourselves, we pool our knowledge, and thus we're beginning to make sense of the whole thing. And you've got to always make sense of everything you say and everything you do. So then we come on to spiritual gifts, where clairvoyance is there, clairaudience is there. You get these particular gifts of being aware the sensing, the feeling, the awareness, those are spiritual gifts. Painters, orograph people, all spiritual gifts. They're not psychic gifts, they're spiritual gifts. And the reason for that is they must bring in the influence of the Spirit. So what we're going to do tonight is that we're going to put your hands up, those that have done psychometry.
Come
on, get them up. Yes. Yes, love of the sense. Up your hands. Up, 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 up. Those that have been taught.
No, we haven't been taught.
Well, we haven't exactly been taught.
Well, you've done it, have you?
Yes.
Right, let's have two of you. She thinks she's going to be on her own, and you're not.
You sit out there, yeah?
Now we want a man. Let's have a man up here. Who's done it? Would you like to sit here, sir? Now what we're going to do, ladies and gentlemen, is this. We're going to give... we're going to ask them just to close their eyes for a bit, and we're going to take two answers. I'd like Mrs. Yes, if you will. Mrs. Do you know the name? Would you both close your eyes, please? I want you to pick two articles yourself, please. Has anybody else touched this article? Well, you won't get anything from Mrs. Donald, unless Mrs. Donald is in a frightful temper. Because if you have, then they will pick up that particular condition. People can. We have a shock. They can touch an article, a sensitive will feel it. But if nothing like that has happened, no conditions of yours, it's only what we call the instantaneous condition of which comes to people. You can see a person, for example, come towards you, and they're absolutely arrayed in red, and you know immediately they're angry about something. But it isn't a lasting thing, it's just something that's happened, you see. And instead of, they can walk in the street, you can see someone going along, and their colour around them knows that they're in a frightful temper, and something's just happened that's put them right off. And then you go to see them 5 minutes later and it disappears, you see. But it's just those instantaneous things. So a lot of people say, don't let anybody touch the article. Don't take a note of that. Unless they really are very frightful. And then you'll know immediately you touch it. Oh, this person, someone's touched this, it's been very erotic. It's gone. So it's only an instantaneous thing. Right. When you're doing psychometry, the first thing to do is to place the article. Try to forget who it is that it belongs to. Don't search to know who it is. That is the worst thing you can do with psychometry. Don't try to say whether it's a man or a woman. Leave it alone. You're like their company, whether you feel happy with the article. You must learn first to be able to feel for the article. Don't worry about names. Don't take any notes of that. Don't even concern yourself with it. You are to feel the vibrations to know what type of person they are. So in the very beginning, it's something to do with their character you're after. Whether a middle-aged person, whether a young person, but not who they are. You're demanding far too much. You must learn to blend with the article first. And that's what psychology is to learn to blend. And it's like a story that unfolds. You begin at the beginning. And as you go through a story, it begins to unfold as you go along. And that's what psychometry does. It begins to unfold. So what happens is, you start, and then you read back. So you're building up the story, see? you've done, ladies and gentlemen, there the story is. Now you're going to go through it. So you go back into time, not at the beginning. So you build the story not by age, but by events. And that is the difference, because the events are on there. It might be ladies first, and if you will, see what you get, and we'll build from it. Don't worry if you don't always try with psychometry. The quicker you can get to the article, the quicker you can pick up the beginning, the easier it is going to be. Very often your mind goes from one thing to another because you hold it too long, and therefore you miss it. What you have to do is to quickly go into it. I'm a bit deaf, but I think that... Did you hear that, what she said, everyone?
Yeah.
You've got good ears, some of you. Sure? Yes, yes. You feel a middle-aged person? Can I just ask something here? Would you let me to have a look? I don't even know what it is. That's so, therefore, it's a middle-aged person, and I take it you're right, go ahead. That's fine.
I think something to do with war.
Something to do with the war?
Yeah.
So you feel that there is a war condition of some kind. Just go on with it. See, it worries me about middle-aged. Just lying, by the way. 50. You couldn't make it 40. Go ahead. She's definitely picked up someone that's not old, and someone that probably could be in their prime. She picked up something here. To do with war. You'll find out about this particular condition. It is possible that the person might have been born, you see, during the war. This is always what we have to think. May not be involved in war, but could be born in war, or someone very close to them that might have been either injured or something to do with the war. But we'll find that as we go along. Two good signs.
Three children.
You get three children. Oh, all right. We will carry on with that. Carry on. Well, you can give us one more fact, you see, and then we'll explain to you how we do it.
Not a very happy person.
Not a very
happy person.
Happy person.
At the moment.
No, good. Well, yes, that's fine. Right. What do you think the person could be unhappy about? I think you're right.
Nothing very important, just a lot of little things.
A lot of little things, yeah. I see. So you think that there are lots of little things that aren't going right and that might be not very happy at the moment. Would you think the person that you have got there has suffered any sort of crisis in their life? Or are they going through a crisis at the moment?
With war? With the war and a motorbike accident.
I see, you got that. Right, well, first of all, would you close your eyes? I'd like the person to put their hand up where this belongs. Well, do you think you just nod your head? Do you think you're in your prime? Yes, I think you are. And aren't you very happy at the moment? What's the war got to do with you? Were you born during the war or after the war? Well, we'll find out about that. Was there anything about a motorbike accident of any kind? Has there been anything that's happened? Shake your head if it's yes or no. Yes. Right. Now, first, can I just talk to you now? First of all, you're quite right. What a middle-aged or kind person. Of which they will accept. And looking at the person, you're right. So you definitely got it. You definitely felt something to do with the war. We've got to find out a little bit about this. And you felt the person was not particularly happy at the situation that you got. And I asked you a question about this, was it, because I wanted to know something about it, seeing that you picked it up. You felt there were lots of little things, which I think we're going to go through into a lot. So we're now going to tell you who the person is. So will you stand up? So the ring that you've got, you see, the ring would not tell the lady. Let me just hand the ring to you. The ring, other than it obviously is a man's ring, but it's a very well-worn ring. Therefore, it wouldn't tell her particularly whether it was a middle-aged person or not. In fact, to look at it, one would have thought it belonged to a much older person, because it seems to me as though it has some I take it this is your own.
Yes.
And it wasn't passed to you at any time by anyone where war conditions were on.
No.
Nevertheless, that's what she picked up, you see. And what is it? Why is it that she was so persistent with something to do with war? Because she picked it up twice.
Well, I was born just before the war.
Oh, well, he's old enough. she picked that up, so you would. Could there have been anything that could have happened during the war that in any way made any sort of impression upon you? Could there have been anything that happened that has been something that you would remember?
Quite a lot, Gordon, actually.
Sorry?
There is quite a lot during the war.
There is.
Yeah.
Now then, the other thing was, I believe, that there was something to do with a motorcycle accident.
Yes.
Now, could that have happened to you personally?
It did.
Or to anyone close to you?
No, it happened to me.
Yes. So therefore you did get that, you see. So you got there so many facts. And that is what you go for, see, it's the facts that you go for. That means to say that you are now able, first of all, through your psychometry, and not knowing who it is, you've got to get the facts, you see. And you keep working until you've got them right. So we've now established that there was something to do with the war, which I would have queried because I didn't think he was as old as that. But nevertheless, he obviously is.
Thank you.
but nevertheless, he is. And there were things that could have made that in his mind, you see, something that has been there. It would point this war sort of out, all in war out. And in a happy condition, I would think that perhaps there were certain things that I think you could have got clearer as better psychometers holding it and learning. You would have picked it up. Yes, I would think today there are several things that probably are making the man not as happy as he was. There are obviously events that have happened in his life that have made tremendous difference to his life. I think that's what you're getting, you see, because you picked up that he was not happy. And therefore, you had to be sure of that. And you were sure, you didn't move from it. See, that's what you got. That's the correct way to deal with it. And then when I queried it, that I wanted to sort of query to sort of make you think here, you said there were several things. Now, as a psychometrist, you would have asked this, you would have been talking to us about this, you then would have dealt with these things, because that was what you would be there to do. See, yeah? So that is the way in which you deal with it. Now, you didn't obey me, really. Did you? Now, there's one thing you see that is important. You definitely got a motorcycle accident. You definitely got that. What we then would have said to you is, now try, if you will, to sort out why this person is unhappy. Because that's on the article somewhere, you see. And you said several things. Then we would have picked them up. We would have said, well, tell me one of them. You see, yeah? Then when we dealt with that, what do you feel about another? See? Then you're building up the story of the person. Have you got that? Good, Dad. That's fine. Now, ladies and gentlemen, can you now see? Oh, you've taken his ring back. Now, ladies and gentlemen, what is important to see is that when you're training someone for this, don't let thoughts go into their mind. Always pin them down, you see, so that you're watching it very carefully and you are getting some sort of acknowledgement where you can without the person recognizing or listening to the voice. Because a voice can give away so much information. And you can either say, it's just, they're not accepting it or not. That isn't what we want. Training is making them concentrate on it. Sorting them out. You find it most interesting. Because it comes out in things like that. Things that not only surprise the person that's doing it, but then you say, you know, that was right, you see. That was right. That was right. Now let's make sense of it. You see, you get your facts first. Then you make sense of it. Okay? So, you know, I'd have given you 7 out of 10 for that, so not bad. The time has to come when I have to give you 10 out of 10. You know, when you get it absolutely right. But 7 is not bad, you see. 4 would have been good, you know. So you were not so bad.
Right, give me here. Tell me what
you've got. I bet I would have been the author of the title for one answer to the best.
Oh, yes.
When I first picked, you know, I felt as though it was a feeling of a very gentle person. Mm-hmm. And gentle or perhaps small.
And small, as opposed to small person, not good.
Delicate looking.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes. I see, yes. You mean not like us? Okay, others. I would say
when I was holding it like that, I felt a heat in this hand that I've only experienced before when I've been doing it here.
So therefore you're saying a person could either have healing power or received healing power. Someone obviously that understands
healing, yes.
The power. You've got some relation to it.
Good.
Now, what other impressions were you picking up?
The other thing that I could see was a flower arrangement. Red flowers, rather like the roses over there. In a plant pot, and there were several of them.
Good. So they were roses, were they? Right. So we picked up something there. Right. We'll go to deal with it, ladies and gentlemen. Can you tell me how many roses you think there were?
5 or 6.
5 or 6. Good. Right, now let's see where we were. Can we go back to the first one? Because you gave 3 children. How many children have you had?
2, but there could have been 3.
Pardon?
She was quite right, there could have been 3.
There should have been 3. Still only giving you 7. You see, it was something else that you got, that's quite good, you see. You got this. Now, can I won't tell you who the person is just from that, but if you will just close your eyes so that I can ask the person if they will nod their head, 1 or 2 things. Certainly, will you just nod your head as this belongs to you? Mm-hmm. Good. You are nice and delicate. And, you know, not delicate, either. I mean, you are like a nice piece of china, you know, fine china, and small, and et cetera, which is good. Have you at any time done any healing or received healing? Yes, that's good. Now, there was something to do with flowers. They felt power, you see, in the left hand. And that meant to say that you couldn't have that unless there was some purpose to this. And obviously, there has been some development of some kind using power. Now, he got it on his left hand, which is quite interesting, because we'll find out why it came through the left hand as much as it did. The other thing was that he got a plant of roses, and there were 5 or 6, and normally that denotes a family. How many are in your family? Could there be 5? Not 6, but 5. You would accept 5, would you? It could be 5. Good. Right, you can open your eyes now, so the text that you gave been accepted. So we've now got that you have picked up the type of person this belongs to. The person definitely has had some involvement where healing has been concerned. The power you gave is you got a definite warmth from it, which meant to say the person most certainly has had some dealings with power for you to pick it up in that manner. So we accept that. There is a query, which, although she said yes, I wasn't too sure of whether she actually meant, so we're going to now ask her so she gives the voice. How many are there actually in your own personal family?
Four, but there were five.
But there were five. Good. Now we do know then that that is what we have. Is that okay? So you've got the conditions, and you've got the whole thing, starting off. So that means, ladies and gentlemen, we've got them now, and that's what we expect. When you are training someone, don't let them go off into tangents. Always keep them down. Pick out the points that are great. Start them off with what they feel. In both cases, they got the age very near. They got something to do with the war. He was through the war. She got a motorcycle accident, which the gentleman had himself. She got some very good facts. And here we start up again with our friend here, who picked up what type of person. Gentle. Short. He said she was delicate looking. I wouldn't say she was delicate, but certainly I knew what he meant. You see here, that's the point.
I think she
not robust.
So
we definitely get there. And again, which was correct, three children, that's what she put down. In this case, five on a branch. I asked, and she said, there were four now, but there have been five. So now we know that we're correct. Now, that's what you start with. Always the things that you know in psychometry, you can do. And therefore, you build on them. So you give them article after article after article after article until they get absolutely right. See? And then you say, now let us now deal with it. And you can deal with all the things. Don't take them forward into time. Keep them always into what has been. Because that's what he does. And when you've got that right, then we move them over into flower clair sentence. Okay? Now, you know the very good looking. Yes, that's the delicate one.
Thank you, Jack. What's
the great
Jack? I'll tell you later.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we are now going to do, we're going to bring the young lady back. Would you like to come back? And this time, I would like, what you do to come hand back? Yes. I need it. Would you like to come up here? Would you please take the red carnations there, and take the red carnations and ask someone here take one out. Remember that your job now is to tune in. One that appeals to you. Hold it for a moment or two. Oh, the fly itself. Now, that's it. Good. Now, this time, I'm going to ask you to do something quite different. I want you to work your eyes and take this particular flower. Now this flower has nothing to do with the lady that's handed it to you. It has already been chosen by someone here. They've held it for a few moments. And this time, I don't want you to tell me anything about the person that has passed this out. What I want you to do is to hold the flower as especially the blossom part of it, in short lines, that is fine. Then what I want you to do is just hold it there, that I want you to open your eyes and look at it. And as you do so, I want you to tell me what is there, and if possible, anything spiritual about it. The whole of everything you've got to do is spiritual and nothing to do with the person. I want a spiritual contact. Let the flower talk to you. Someone on the other side, you think, spiritual person. Would you feel the person that's...
Somebody here.
Someone living. Right. Go ahead.
Full of fun.
Sorry?
Full of fun and life.
Full of fun and life, yes. That's the person that's chosen this. Now, who do you think they have on the other side? Who do you think is them? Because you, that can link you up.
Grandmother.
What sort of person?
Very strict.
Very strict, yes. Right. Did you get a name?
Iris.
Right. Good. Anything else? Look at the petals. See what they do think is telling you. Let it talk to you. You now know it belongs to us, a person that you think is very spiritual, that they want to get a message to. And the person might, perhaps, have thought of someone as they were holding the article. But if so, they would be thinking of someone on the other side. Now, you feel that there is a grandmother there. I'd like to get a little bit more. You've got the name of Iris, which we will ask in a few moments if you meet her. Change. You see, what I felt here was there seemed to be a change that she was giving from one experience to another, you see. And it was as though they were sort of saying to you that life is serious and there is a change coming and you've got to understand that, that sort of thing. Do you follow what I mean? Because of the two, there has to be a reason of why she got the contrast between this and this sort of a strict or serious, or you've got to take things seriously. Do you follow what I mean? So obviously they picked something up. Could there have been anything in your mind at that particular time you were holding this that might have attracted the person to you that has been given to you? And could there have been any thought about your life just at that moment? Were you thinking of anything particular? Right, you've been opening your eyes. The lady that you that we get, we had this problem, it was Mrs. Steele, the visitor there, you see here, Jessie, and she's the one that actually got it. Now, when I was saying to you about this, the important thing to me was, A, that you picked up the lady, she has accepted it, because she said that she was a person who was serious and took life seriously. And I think that was correct, what you said, wasn't it? And also, that she is a person that is happy, you know, she likes, she enjoys, she's enjoying life, and that there were the two contrasts. Therefore, we have to try and understand what they're trying to get at. And when they're saying that, they are saying that there is a reason now of where they've got to take things very seriously. And that there was obviously a deep spiritual contact. Now, don't you find the difference between psychometry, which I was asking you to do, then you're dealing with this entirely different. And the way in which you're dealing with it is entirely different. Did you notice that?
Yeah.
And the way in which you receive is entirely different. Because on one, ladies and gentlemen, you've got it with you. With the other, it's a sort of spiritual thing in your mind. Did you feel that? That's right. You see. Right, I'll give you another second. Now, it's not easy, ladies and gentlemen, to be trained here, because we have to be very serious about the whole thing. And what is important is that in these matters, it's defining the difference between one and the other. And letting people tune in on an entirely different level. So that you are training people's minds that when they're doing one thing, they've got to do it than what you're asking them, not wonder. You can't have people wandering, giving spiritual things through psychometry. You must do it at the right time, using the right conditions the whole of the time. So they develop each gift, or else you'll have a conglomeration of gifts, meaning nothing. You don't get anywhere with it. You must specialize each one separately and be trained very seriously with it. Now you can make lovely evenings. You see, circles, in my opinion, you can make them so interesting because you can have a circle, you see, where you're all sitting there and no one gets anywhere, but you can have circles where you build a power and then you make them work. Have an evening where you say, now look, we're all going to work, so you can get a lot of articles there from all kinds of people, and say, now come on, Mr. Stones and Miss Stones, all of you got to work, make them all do it, take them one at a time, write everything down, don't let them know whose it belongs to, then prove it, you see. Yeah. So you get in the minds, enjoying it, you see. And once they know, sometimes you can give them an article of themselves. And there they are, picking it up, you see, here. And saying lovely things about themselves. They don't believe it afterwards. But they've got it. That's the point we're trying to get at, you see. So you can make it most interesting. And that's what it is. As a medium, we must make it interesting. And that you must train to make the evening as though you want to stay there all night. And that's where you work at your best. Because you are being directed along the channel. And once you know you are able to do it, you want to keep doing it, you see. Because if you're bringing it out, and then you say, oh no, I don't want any work from you now until next week, keep it down. So they're conserving everything. And they're not allowing the mind to run away onto the things that don't really matter. Okay? Now, We're now going to show you. I wonder if Mrs. Haig would like to come down, please. And I'd like our little friend,
Val.
Now, the reason I've asked Mrs. Haig is because she's an experienced teacher. And what I'm going to ask you to do, Mrs. Haig, if you sit here, what I want you to do is to just sit whilst you're working and whilst you're waiting. And if you can make contact, then what I would like you to do is, while the young baron is working, I'd like you to stand just with her while she's working. Just stand there and give what you know we have to do, and that is to help her. Don't interfere, just give her the power. I want to show you the difference, you see. When you've got someone that is working with a reader, a working reader working with someone else, the difference between the way in which they work. But you've got to give a contact first. That's difficult. Look at them, how serious they are. Sorry? Well, that's all the better. Your power will be greater. Conserved it.
Harry, when you are a lady and she has her hair drawn right back in a bun, and I feel she's not grandmother, but she'd be aunt, great aunt, I feel. And she comes very close to you because at this moment there's something going to come about in your family, a whole lot of people have been gathering together, and it's some connection with this lady. She would have liked if she'd been there to be with you. Now, I get it. Before, I know a long time ago, I said to you, you will pick up a case and go quickly someplace. Well, this is still to come. I know it hasn't come yet, but I feel within the next 3 months, this will come around. Can I bring you the name of Elizabeth? Bring you Donald. That's a new, not you, new. I know it's a Sunday. But if you look well back into your life, this would have been a young person by the name of Donald, a neighbour's child who probably don't remember much about him, but he came home very suddenly. And at that time, you should have, you felt compassion for them. And even way back then, you had this gift within you, although it's coming forth now with you, that you can feel more spirit in and around you. Even in those days you had them. You would have said, oh, my imagination, but it wasn't your imagination even then. You've had a kindness across here? Yes. And it's worried you for some time, but you've never said very much about it. No. You listen to other people's troubles, I think, more than you concern with your own health. Will you slow down and concern yourself about you? I'd bring you Dorothy or Dolly. Yes. And she stands and she does this to you. And she says, you've heard what's been told to you just now, to slow down and to look after yourself, not to concern yourself about the young ones. They have to get on with their own way of life, but you concern yourself about you now. Sometimes you seem to go round and round and round like you're doing a whirl wheel. Yeah, and we're fast. I bring a gentleman here who's very dark of hair. He stands behind you and he puts his hands on his shoulder. I don't know why. When you were young, did your father used to... You were the favourite of the family. Yes, because I feel it's him and he stands with his hands behind you tonight. He said, I will give you the power that you require. In all things, as you walk through life, your father will keep from now straight, because I feel it's gone up and down like a switchboard for a long time. But now it will go smooth. Gives you great blessings. He brings you anniversary time for June, July months. He brings beautiful roses to you.
And he also thanks you for what you've been doing of late. Now, I don't know what you've been doing of late, but he says, thank you. From spirit, he brings you three red roses. He doesn't say why the three, but he gives you the three. You know the why the three have been given. Three roses have been left. It's all well.
Thank you very much. Now, you notice, ladies and gentlemen, that she tied up the loose ends. That's always what you expect a meeting to do. And always and must tie up the loose ends. Don't leave anything up in the air. They're always tied up. Don't attempt ever to give too much to the person. Always give what you receive, exactly as you see, and then tie it up all the time. You'll notice that about the roses, she asked about the roses. She obviously was seen it. She wanted the person to know, and then after a little chat between the two, I think you understood it. Is that correct? Good. So she tied it up, you see. Don't leave anything up in the air. Always tie it up. Okay? So, how long ago did you say everything you were?
I had a setback.
Oh, you had a setback.
There was a man sat there. I wanted to speak about this because maybe he'd be able to help. There's a fellow sat there and I went to him first and he kept drawing me back to him. And it just was like somebody who was trying to draw a blind thing. Okay. But I got on all right for the rest of the reading, but the next day I was just shattered.
Oh, yes.
And I wondered if it was the
fellow sat
here that had done it.
Well, what can very often happen, you can pick up a condition where the sort of barrier comes, and of course you know that although it shatters you, you've still got to get over it.
Mm-hmm. He accepted everything that was given to him, but he still seemed to draw me back towards him.
Oh, yes, well, probably they were attempting, or whoever it was, they probably wanted a little bit more out of you. We've got a problem in choosing what you have. Yes, you must do that. Never stay too long, because it wears you out, you see. If you stay with a person too long, it wears all the conditions. That's all they did. You see, that doesn't happen again. You know, good girl. She's older than me, you know. Right, everybody. Good. Sorry?
You said to make it age, didn't you?
It doesn't. We're the same age.
Oh, good.
Very young and hard. Now, I'm going to ask the meeting here to sit with you because I want to follow the contact. She's going to give you her power. So that she'll say she'll have another setback. She'll give you all the power. Carry on, darling.
I just have to pick some.
Yes, haven't you picked anybody yet? Haven't you got a contact yet?
I've heard something in particular.
Pardon?
I thought to talk to the lady in the sort of smoky pink dress. Are you looking round just now?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Oh, thank you.
You have a lady with her?
Yes.
How do you feel about her? Do you feel she's a relative or a friend?
No, I think she's a relative.
A relative?
Yes.
Speak up.
And I think that she was the sort of lady that was a very open lady. She was a family organiser.
Yes.
And she's the sort of lady that I feel her sleeves would have always been rolled up. You know, she'd always had them unbuttoned and rolled up to here, sort of ready to. And I see her making and baking.
Yeah.
A lot, a sort of very busy lady in household lives. Um, think she was an unhappy lady because I think she accepted a lot, but I feel that her life probably wasn't a very easy one all the time. I think she had struggles to get over a lot of the time, and I think she was a very strong person.
Yes.
Don't stop, keep talking. And the other thing is, you've given quite evidence, the lady seems to know who you're talking about. So don't try to give, at the moment, more than what is necessary. You've got it. Have you any idea who you think the person might be?
I think it's a mother or a grandmother. I think probably a mother, actually.
Yes. They were of the same mould.
Yes.
It could be either.
I think she's coming to sort of say that she's coming to give you some strength just now. She's coming to sort of bolster you up and be your backup for some reason. I don't know why. She's not telling you why. I just feel that you need some extra strength just now to sort of face something that's on the moon. And I think it's going to be towards the end of the summer months, perhaps into autumn, before there'll be a change in that condition, that it'll improve.
I see.
And you'll see a significant change about that time in this situation, different bits. It's all different than what it is.
Thank you.
You should show me daffodils, a bunch of daffodils in a crystal vase. And it's on a table, a loose table.
You've seen that?
Mm-hmm.
A table with a cloth on and daffodils.
Yes.
Then will you see that means something to you, see?
Yes.
Yeah? And also, do it when the daffodils come out, you know, when they're really out, not as they are at the moment, but you see them really growing in gardens and sort of thing. Take some, put them into the house, because they have some contact with the lady that is...
She always had flowers.
She did. That's fine. That's what you want to say. Okay?
Thank you.
Good. She's done very well, you see. She's got the contact. Always when you're getting it, try to sense that don't try to give too much until you've fitted it in. And you're quite right to say you thought it was a grandmother or a mother, but you felt it was more a mother. And I think you accepted that.
Yes, I felt it was my mother.
Yes. You see, it saves then a lot of trouble of going into too many things, because you've now thinned it down, you see. And that's what you want to do. And if you're not quite right, don't worry about it. Keep going until you've got something where you can say, but this lady knows about it. So therefore, there is a relationship, you see, here. And once you've established it, then go into what you've got, so that you're getting the contact at the right time, and your power is built. Is that okay?
Yes.
I don't think she did well.
Okay.
I see her standing at, you know, the old-fashioned, like, two sinks with one of those mangled things
yes.
over it. And it's as if she's pushing the clothes through, but she's having a real job to get the handle over to push, you know, to wring the clothes out.
Well, now you've hit it as a symbol. First of all, you must remember something like that.
Yes, I do.
That's right. Will you tell us what it is so she will know?
In our kitchen, this was a new house, and it was the first time she'd had a ringer. Until that time, she'd had a wooden mangle, and she was not fit to be working at this time. And it grieved me to see her having to do it, so I was happy when she got a ringer.
Now, you see, that is the further evidence to prove who she is. So you say to the person, quite rightly, this is what I see. Is this any evidence to prove the person's me? Then she says, yes. Because now you've established without question who it is. Now, what you can do now is make that into a symbol that has been given to her into her life. It's known by the person. She knows exactly the situation. And now what you've got to tell her to do is to remember she can't go on doing all the things that she's trying to do at the present time at your service. Will you accept that?
Yes.
And wouldn't your mother come back and say so?
Yes.
That's right. That's what she's doing.
Can I say something, please?
Yes, please.
Just before the young lady spoke, something happened to my eyes that seemed to sort of squint, and I swear that I saw a sort of gossamer form of my mother behind her.
Oh, that's lovely. Well, the power was there, you see. That's the reason we knew that, you know, the contact was the right. You're on the right lines. You are made to work, and you must keep working. But that's the way to do it. Always get your evidence. Don't spoil it. Wait until you've got something at which you got. Then ask, can this be evidence to confirm who the person is? And she immediately says, oh, yes, you see here. Then symbolize it. Because the mother's trying to tell you what you can't tell you with words, in simple. Okay? And then what you've got is, you say, now, what happened to your mother in that situation where she found the card? She's trying to tell you, don't do the same thing. And then you follow it. She's made sense of what she's got.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, can you see what we mean?
Yes.
Have you picked it up as well? Good girl. There we are. Now sit down. Mary, you're all right. You can go now. I think she's done very well for us. Serious illness, and if so, what sort of illness do you think he passed through? You see, you've given us a tall, thin man, but then you said he was highly coloured. In other words, he got a good colour. That's what you felt.
Yes, I think it was a kind of, I feel it was a wasting illness, it was a progressive and
good.
Let's
keep to that. So, you've got a tall, thin man that passed away with some serious illness that was like wasting. Illness that was gradually depleting. How old, approximately, do you think he was? Middle life? Young?
No, he was a fair age. He was into old age.
He was a fair age. Mm-hmm. Now, you've got this link. Can you get either a name or two names? Or can you get who you think it belongs or where you think it belongs from these people?
I feel I get the name Tom. Or Tom.
That's fine. Now then, ladies and gentlemen, we've got, first of all, the name of Tom. We've no idea whether this is someone, Tom, that's living or someone that's passed. But we've got a tall gentleman, and a tall gentleman and thin, who's passed away with some, he was getting on in years, he wasn't a young man. That's as far as we can go with it. And that he had a very serious illness that gradually, from obviously being a very strong, powerful man, he's come down to being very slight because he had this illness that was wasting. That's, I think, what you've got, isn't it? Splendid. Anyone that can pick anything up like that, and also the name of Tom. Yes, two people on the side. Yeah.
One here.
You've got to get some. Oh, another one there. Fine. Oh, well, you can't go back to her.
Yeah.
You can't even fit you, you see. This is the one of the things that happens that we've now got to sort out. Here's another name.
Well, I can't get another name, but it's
unfair. Why can't you get another name? You've already got Tom.
I feel that perhaps the second name might start with a G.
All right.
He's showing me.
Initial G. Now, what are you showing? Let's go.
A newspaper headline, but I can't see what the headline is.
So therefore, the person that sometimes is bringing something up and happened that was in the paper in a headline of some sort. Is that what you're saying?
Mm-hmm.
Good. Now, the three people that are here, could there have been anything? It's here, is it? Good.
I feel that perhaps this headline is also something to do with this man.
Could that be correct?
Yeah.
That's fine. That's what you've got. Now that's thinning it down to the one. I don't think you can place that.
No, I can't.
Now we've got the person we're after. You see? Good girl. I go in here.
We've got one up here.
One at the back.
I can take the Tom, the G, and the headline.
And you can get the headline. Right. Still got two people. Can you place the G?
No.
Yeah. There you are. Thin it down, you see? Now go straight into it with what you read. The presence, why the man is here. Don't give to spoil the contact. Always sort of keep it where it is. And now keep it directed. What do you feel? You've now got the person that can place all the facts.
Well, I don't feel it's a direct family link to you and your immediate family.
Right. Keep the link with the man. Don't be watching her face too much. Keep the link with the man. That's the person you've got to hold your concentration on.
I think he either is linked to your husband or he's got some concern about him.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Yes, she's accepting it. Good.
He's letting me see a horse harness, you know. Sort of a bridle and things like that. But, here again, see, I don't feel it's got anything to actually do with horses. I feel it's just sort of telling a sort of indication of, you know, sort of get geared up and ready to work or something like that.
That's right. Say it. That's right.
Yes.
Would you place that?
Yes.
She's placing it. It's good. Keep going with it. Mm-hmm. That's where you are.
Well, now he's letting me see a horse, sort of, and he's tearing on at a fair rating.
Yes.
And he's sort of giving the horse his head and letting him fly at his own rate.
Yes.
So I think if he does, if your husband, I think who this is meant for, does pick up the cudgels and get on with it, that things will sort of tear on and go on up here and problems.
Yes, I can accept that.
That is that we have to do.
Can you place that
yes,
like that?
Yes, I can.
That's fine.
Talking about two children.
Yes.
The elder one. He's laughing about it, and I think is he a bit of a tomboy or a bit of a terrier, or she? I don't know if it's a he or a she. But he's sort of laughing about him. Is he a sort of very? I keep saying he's not supposed to be here. A very sort of mischievous, impish little person.
It's the youngest one.
It's the youngest one.
That description is perfect, but it's the youngest one.
Okay. He's laughing about this kind of one. He says it's a bit like when we use the little boy.
Yes.
Why are you staying with Samoa? Why are you trying to get some more? Why are you still with the contact?
I'm afraid, huh?
Well, I didn't.
Because I'm labouring it.
That's right. You feel need, you see. Uh-huh. You've got it across what you've got. You've no need to labour it. You've got some very good stuff. What you should do if you're going to do anything at all is to go through it, see that you've hammered over every point that's necessary. So you've tied up every loose end, leave everything else alone. And while you're doing that, you're feeling for your next contact. Okay? Right, tie it up then. Go through it again. Ask her if she understands it.
Yes, you do understand, and you can accept.
You've got all, leave the other alone that you don't understand. And while you've got that, where else do you want to go? Where else is on the other side? There's a host of them here.
I want to go to this view. I don't know why I want to come to this view.
Did you just say you wanted to go to the Rosemary?
Yes, I just
feel. Never do that when you are working with me. Okay. Because you are going to a person and calling them by their name, and that will in actual fact get your mind in tune with the person, completely ignoring who she is. What you must do is always say, I want to come there. Don't mention that. I'll tell you why. Because the name will go right into your subconscious mind. And even though you may not know the person, the name will create something. Leave it alone. Always ignore people's names. You usually find, I find it very difficult because I've got used to that. Even the person, even if I know the person, I can't even think of their name. It goes. Because if your mind tunes into that name, okay? Leave Rosemary out of it. And just go to her. And you'll get away with this once, but never do it again.
Two people. Grandparents. You've got a grandmother and a grandfather.
All four are.
This is difficult. The lady, I feel, has got. I can't quite work it out. I feel as if she's got a sort of shawl on, but for some reason it's got a knot here, some kind of fancy fastening or something like that. And I feel that she's playing with it, you know, sort of like worrying it, you know, that thing. And she's.
Could I just step in? Could you tell me whether the lady had a habit when she was sort of talking to you of handling anything? Can you remember or not?
I never met either of my grandmothers.
Pardon?
I never met either of my grandmothers.
You didn't.
But I've seen a picture of one.
And now she got a shawl.
A shawl and a brooch.
That's
right. Pinning it.
Well, therefore, what has happened is she's trying to get that across, you see, here. There always has to be a reason why she has. So the person that's with her is the one where she has the photograph. Okay? So while you're saying that, while you're getting it, just saying to her, can this mean something to you? Because you're then keeping it going. You've got to keep it going all the time, you see? You've got to get her response as well. So now she's told us that she can't remember her grand, but she has seen a picture where she's got the shawl and the brooch. So therefore you say, well, that's why they've given it to me. Okay? So you're keeping it going, and while you're doing that, you're thinking. You see, you've got to keep on going all the time. See, they're not going to keep popping things into your mind. You've got to keep working with it. Okay? Mm-hmm. I'd break a heart if I had it for 6 months. Keep going. You've got it, you see. Now keep going. Speed it up.
Red flannel, for some reason, she says red flannel, and I can't break that out.
I'm sure you haven't picked that up with me while you've been talking to me. My mother's always my mother. Whenever we had anything wrong, she always used to say, let me get some red flannel.
Well, I was going to say, I feel that she wants to
give you red flannel because she feels that that was, she obviously used that to wrap around people when she felt that they needed looking after, and I think she wants to give you some red flannel.
Good. Now, can I just now tell you something? You've given her that. Now, what does red mean? The colour.
Well, it depends what kind of red.
Right.
Because it
well,
can mean anger. Or it can
that's mean right. Now, why don't you start thinking what kind of red it is?
Well, red flannel is scarlet.
It's scarlet red. Mm. Good colour. Right. Mm. She's going through a period herself in her own mind where she wants to be absolutely certain about everything in her life. She herself has come to a point in her life now. Now you've got something, you seem to work on that now. While you're waiting for the other context. Scarlet, you see, is that giving you that good reason, first that, once you start getting anything in colour, absolutely gentle. Because that's what the spirit is trying to tell you. So therefore, there is something, scarlet's a very good colour to see. It means that through all the troubles, because she's had to have a willpower, she's had to make decisions in her own life. Now she's coming to the harvest of it. And she's just hoping that all the troubles and various things that she's had aren't just going to be of no avail. So she's expecting and hoping that her life is going to change to that level at which she's been working for some time. And spirit people are saying, keep on going where you are, it'll come right in the end. That's what they're saying. Does it make sense?
Oh, it makes an awful lot of sense.
See what I mean? You're missing the points, you see. Mm-hmm. Now, that's why you have to have a teacher with you, bringing out these points, you see. Bringing them out all the time, making you work on it. So your mind's actually you, you see. And then there's our grandmothers come back for that particular reason. And then as you've got it, you see, everything begins to take place. You don't have to miss a point, you see. If they even show me a matchstick, I can then begin to realise what they're trying to tell me. Because while I'm waiting to get the next contact, I'm using that as my symbol. Because that's what they've given it to me. Because something's happening, it isn't flowing, so they give me that. And I whip it up very, very quickly, and as that's going on, they pop something else into my mind to give me the behind the people. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, don't you think she's done well?
Yeah. Yes.
Don't clap too hard. Thank you very much. Do you remember what I said to you? Do it as I do. Contact. Absolutely. Tie it all up.
Can I come to you, love?
Probably, yeah.
Because as I've been sitting there, there's been this little wee gentleman with a bonnet on it. And he's been sort of pacing up and down, waiting to get through to you. And he's a relative, it's either your father or grandfather side of the, you know, that side of your family. Okay. And he's just popped a pipe or something into his mouth as recognition, because I was asking him to give us something more. So you understand who it is.
Yes.
Okay. And as he's coming back there, he's bringing back a short sort of memory for you, just to give you a wee bit more evidence, because of somebody playing a melodeon or something. You understand?
Yes.
Because it seems to be that, and he's telling me there was quite a lot of music and happiness and sort of sing songs that went on, and he's saying it wasn't always when they were sober either. Okay? You understand that? And he's quite a cheery guy, this. You know, he really was sort of life and soul. And although he had a tremendous amount of difficulty in his life, he always came up smiling. And in fact, he's telling me that if he'd fallen into a midden, he would have come out with a fiver stuck to his pocket. And you know why he's saying that, okay? Because it's something he used to say to you. Well, love, why he's coming back is purely through, there's a tremendous amount of love coming towards you, but at the same time, he's saying to me that over the past 3 months, although things seem to have been coming smooth, you've been a wee bit troubled, and there seems to be something within the family that's troubled you. Can you accept that?
Yes.
And he's saying, there is one thing about you But although you're always going ahead and always smiling, you get a wee bit troubled. But you are particularly worried slightly about this, whatever it is. I've been asking him what it is, and he's saying, mind your own business. So I'll leave it at that. But you've really got to try and move forward, he said. And what he's showing me, and it must be symbolic for you, he's showing me the you know the old boats in the Dee?
Yes.
Do you remember Ogilvy's boats, as I remember them? They used to have boats in the Dee, but they used to go rowing in a Sunday. You remember, and she's younger than you are. Well, what he's showing me is you and us both going against the tide. He's telling you to turn around and go with the tide for a wee while. Okay? And the sort of thing will pass on, and then everything will be tied up for you. There's a birthday coming up shortly.
Yes.
Right? Because he just showed me this box with a lot of ribbons on it, and it's a pink ribbon. And there's got to be one or two happy surprises for you. And you've got some relatives who don't live in Aberdeen. They live away from Aberdeen.
Yes.
Well, there's got to be a two or three visitors. Do you know about this already?
Yes.
You do? Okay, that's super. So it's got to be quite jolly, and he's bringing out his melodeon again. So I take it there's got to be a lot of happiness about it, and he's got to bring you a lot of joy. So I'll leave you with that. Okay?
Okay. Are you ready?
Can I just say a few words before we start?
Yes.
You know, Tom and I visit your centre quite a bit, and Tom and I both like to say that we do appreciate the hospitality and the friendship that you've given us. We really do love coming to this centre, and there's a lot of love inside here, and it helps us a lot. And I didn't expect to be up here, but I'm really pleased to be anyway. Thanks anyway for your love and your hospitality, because it really is very nice. And as I've been sitting there, I feel I'm somewhere at the back, but I'm not entirely sure where. But I seem to get the name of either Alec or Alex. And this is a very tall gentleman. And whether he walked with a stick towards the end of his life, or whether he stooped because he was tall, I'm not sure. And I feel this would be the man who wore the kilt. Can anyone take this? You can. And I feel this is either a father or grandfather.
No.
It's not. That's what I was getting.
He is relative.
He's relative.
Yes, he's relative.
That's my mistake. But you can accept the description of this gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And would you have known if you passed with a heart condition?
No, I couldn't tell
you
that
was tell me. That's
when
just
I was
something
very
that
young.
I felt. No. Okay, then let's see how it's coming. I feel that this gentleman was stooped, and I'm trying to interpret in a symbolic way that maybe that you've had your problems on your shoulders in the past, and if you put your shoulders back and look ahead, then it is, and it's easy to say, I know, but this gentleman, I felt, had a lot of strength of character.
Yes, definitely.
That's right,
yes.
This gentleman, this is what I'm feeling. And he says, come on lass, you've got that. Okay, you
yes.
know, you can put your shoulders back and you can face the world, okay? And the name of Mary is now
yes.
coming in, you
okay.
can accept
yes,
that.
I can
and
do.
I feel this must be very close linked to
mother.
You because I'm getting a lovely feeling and it must be out of your mother.
My mother.
It's a lovely, lovely feeling, and the satellite of love coming across to you must have been very close to your heart.
Yeah.
And she is talking about a brooch.
Yes.
Okay, that's a memory link for you, a brooch that she passed to you.
Yes, I have all her jewelry.
Oh, yes, is it a cameo brooch?
I have a cameo, but it's more mine.
It's more yours.
Yes, it is.
It's all about a cameo brooch. So this would have been a gift from someone.
Yes, it was.
To you, this
yes.
cameo brooch. That's lovely. And a special memory link on this cameo
yes.
brooch. You can accept that.
Oh, I can do,
that's
yes.
That's lovely. It doesn't mean... So that's very nice. And there's such a lot of love coming around you.
Thank you.
And you know that they're with you. They're there to help you.
Yes, I do know that.
And this gentleman... says, right, put shoulders back, and the love's there,
So you can only go forward from there.
Thank you. Very nice. Okay.
Next.
I seem to be drawn to you, my love. Without, yes, you're a constraint.
Yes.
And as I looked at you, I've got the name of George. I don't know if it's, let me see. I don't feel this is a spirit link. I feel that this is George on earth. Do you know of George? You can't place George, not in the family.
No.
You can't place it, let's see if I get you know. I just was drawn to you. Nobody round that area can take George on earth. You can take a George on earth. There must be a condition around this gentleman.
Yes.
He needs help in some way.
Yes.
Okay, because I know that it wasn't a spirit contract. Okay. So I get this condition. And I feel this gentleman needs a shoulder to cry on.
Yes, perhaps.
Okay. So sometimes all we have to do is listen.
Yes.
You can't solve anybody's problems, but to listen is a way of healing, isn't it?
Yes.
And I feel that George needs a sympathetic ear.
Yes.
Okay. I love this. So that's going to you. And Anne, the name of Anne is being called across, and I feel this is a someone in spirit. The name of Anne. And I feel that this person passed young. Wasn't an elderly person, and I don't even think it's someone in your direct family. I feel this is an Anne. Couldn't you go back to your mother, your time with your mother? And I felt that your mother had a great neighbour friend.
Yes.
I feel the Anne is linked in there.
I see.
I feel that this is where Anne links in with this great neighbour of your mum. Any strong thing now. I seem to have died on something.
Yes. There's no one there with the initials A-S, is there? A-S, the two initials. She was picking it up, and I kept on getting A and an S for some reason.
I know someone, A-S.
Oh?
I know someone alive, A-S, and her name is Anne.
Oh, you did? And she's named Anne?
Uh-huh. I've got a friend who's Anne, and her surname is S.
That's
so
right.
Oh,
I've got a friend that's Anne, and surname S as well.
Oh, you have? So there it is.
Is the name there? Is the name Simmons anywhere around there? No? But Anne S you can take.
That's where the Anne is.
That's
anyway.
Where the Anne is.
There are two ladies that both can place it.
Mm.
Not the person that you've been talking to.
This is someone on the earth, is it not? Would this be a dark haired lady?
Yes.
Dark haired lady. Are you a dark haired lady? It must be for you then, a dark haired lady. And I always feel when there's someone on earth that there is a problem in, or there's help is needed for a person on earth. That's how I feel when I get this. Could you accept that this lady has need of some help in some way?
Could be. I haven't seen
you
her
haven't
for a
had
few
a contact
weeks.
With her. Well, perhaps if you could contact her, you may find out that perhaps a bit of depression or something like that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Could you tell me whether at some time you've been rather close to this person? Could there have been a friendship, a very close friendship at any time?
Yes.
If during that time, was there someone that passed over? Because I rather feel that there's a gentleman on the other side that seems to know of your link with this person, and is just there. I would have thought that you'd been where there'd been gatherings, or that you'd been together in something, and that you'd met other people as well, but together, you see, as though they'd be part of it. And there seems to be someone there that's trying to get through, and is talking about this particular relationship of those days, and what has happened in your own life since, you see here, as though things are not what they were in those days. Your life has completely changed from those days to what you are going through at the present time. And I think they're relating this back as though you've made many decisions since that time in your own life, and their life may not be quite the same. But I feel there's been more happened in your life, as though events have been more than could have happened in theirs. It's as though they're recalling back various things that I feel that you have been tremendously guided, if I may say so, from the other side, because I asked them to show it up so we could see it. And I think this is what they were doing. They were trying to say that there were times that when you've needed a lot of help, and it has come to you in a very mysterious way. And it is from those days, you see here, that your life has changed. That's what it's all about. But you have linked up with someone that passed away, that belonged to this person, and I think is waiting for the opportunity when perhaps they can help through you, through prayer, bringing about various things that they do require in their own life at the present time. They may improve as time goes on.
Thank you.
Are you finished? Okay, you can sit down.
Thank you.
Where did you go?
Seems to be more of an acquaintance, and I'm seeing a Gordon Highlanders badge. Okay, and this gentleman who I've got the initial G, is it?
Yes.
Right. Okay. And while I'm getting this, he's just standing there and saying, you know, what are you playing about that? You know, you were never like this when I knew you, when you were younger. And the reason why he's saying it is, it has a sort of, as he's saying to me, you were never one to let get life down on you. And he feels that you're just sort of letting life go down slightly, whereas you should be coming to pull up. Okay, can you accept that?
I was, yes.
Yeah. And as he's going, he's saying that I don't know why he's giving me this, but he's showing me two boots, army boots, tied together, as though somebody's trying to walk like that. And he's now cutting it, and he's saying to walk forward with greater confidence. Can you accept that?
Yes.
Okay. And you want me to cut off there and go
yes.
up there?
Yes.
Okay. Right into the corner?
Yes.
I felt that the gentleman was at a crossroads.
Yes.
Spiritual.
Yeah, I feel that there's a crossroads for you and you're not sure which way that you should go. I just felt that you are definitely at a crossroads.
I'm not going to have
that.
That's fine. Right into the
very
corner. Yes. Can I come to you?
There you go.
I've got a soldier here with two cross legs, but it doesn't matter. as I'm coming up towards you, what I'm seeing here, I'm just getting a place, I'm to come through, and what I'm seeing is a loch with hills around it. And there's trees. Can you place that place at all?
Yes.
Right. And as I'm coming closer to it, I see someone walking along the pathway in, I wouldn't say contemplating, but very deep in thought. Does that make sense to you?
Yes.
Yes or no?
No.
No, okay, we'll try and get that before.
Could you relate it to herself, do you think?
Well, that's coming to, because I've had a strong feeling it was yourself walking along here. Does your thought stray to this place when you're feeling down at all?
Yes.
Right, okay, that's what it is. Because I see you walking, so it's obviously symbolic to see you walking along this pathway. And it would appear as if all of a sudden the sunrise is coming up. And there's a tremendous amount of sunshine coming over. So I would interpret that, Bob, that obviously you've possibly come through quite a difficult time and it's starting to lift now, because that's what I'm usually showing. Does this make sense to you?
Yes.
Right, good. And I'm seeing two pathways now, and you're coming up to the two pathways, and you've stopped, and you're looking at both the pathways, and all I can say to you is that you will be directed, because I'm seeing a very strong sign going one way. Okay, so if you come up to a situation like this, watch for all the signs and make sure you follow them. And the person who's coming in now, it seems to be an oldish lady that I've got here. She's very quiet, very straight, but a very quiet person. And it's not a mother. It's certainly not a mother. I'm feeling it's more like an aunt or some relative of the family, but I'm getting a very faint sort of contact here. And she's a very straight, very quiet, but she had been a person who had strong qualities about her. It could be very, very strict at times. Could be very strict at times. You don't know about it, do you? Mm-hmm. Well, I'm not getting her name at all, but I'm getting a strong feeling that I'm getting a name, Mary. 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 I'm getting Uchart, but I don't know whether it's actually in my street or whether it's named Mary Uchart. Okay. Well, just think about it, will you please? Because I'm sure it's certainly not a mother link, but it's someone close, and I think it's a relative or somewhere about, yeah.
Okay.
Except
I take it you're does anybody else here know the name of is it her coffee?
Uchart.
Someone here knows that name. I think that he's got it with that. You do. Would you know anyone by the name of Mary and in that family or close to you?
No.
The name of Mary doesn't mean anything at all.
No.
Even if you separate the two. If you know an Urquhart family, would you know a Mary somewhere?
No.
Well, not with that family. And you don't know it other than the family, in your own family or your wife's family. Mm-hmm. I have a feeling that you might have got another link, you see, here. Because the idea is, what I was making him do, was to keep on picking up links, you see. And I think that came in to move him on. You see, that was what I was after. And I think that was what was taking place, you see, to get you.
I could take the Mary, and I used to live in Accurate Road.
Pardon?
I could take the Mary, and I used to live in
Accurate Road. Oh, you did? Well, that would be your next link, yeah, you see. So, when you do, if you're seeing it fade away, they're asking you to fade out, then they've got your next link, you see here. Now, if you're going to tell me the colour of that lady, not the colouring as you see her there, and you were sensing anything, what colour would you say would be her colour? Green, exactly. That's exactly what you're about. Oh. Mm. While he was talking, while he was there, I saw the whole of that colour come right out, you see, and I thought, I'll just see if she's watching, you see, and if she should have picked up green, you see. You're going through a period when your life really is changing. It's coming really out of the winter into the spring, and by the summer, you'll find that the whole of your life will be so different from what it is at the present time. You're going to blossom out, and I think that you've waited a while for this. You seem as though you've been on the same road too long. There's got to be something that's got to be put right. Would you accept that?
Yes.
But it was right with you, so I thought, I must see if she's been following you. And if so, that's what was there. You're absolutely right, that was the colour.
and it was right up the wall, you know, and you were right in it. And it was quite fascinating to see the way in which it all came up, you know, as though it was really a moment of great promise. Now, Liz, you can both go down.
Yes.
Train mediums and train people unless you know exactly what you're doing. And you must never let anyone, no matter who they are, go off. They must always, no matter whatever they give, you've got to find it. Don't let people's imaginations run away with them. And always remember that keep them down, you see, keep them down. Get the facts over. And if there is something that isn't going over, don't ask them to take it away with you. Try to find out what it is. And a medium can help another. We got this when we saw Mrs. Haig come along with Val there, and together you could see the power building, and you knew that Mrs. Haig was giving her all the help she possibly could. And Val was taking very good opportunity of it, you see here. She really was. And you see, whatever you said to Val, she stuck to it, which I was very pleased with. I was trying to push her on, and she was holding back, quite right to do so, and she was quite clear on her, and she built up some extremely good contacts. In fact, one of the evidence you gave to the lady, I thought, was really extraordinarily good, and it was obvious to me that she's one that should be encouraged to do a lot more work, and I would suggest to the church, in sittings, especially, or a group of four, occasionally take a group of four, or a group of three, or a group of five, and lock her in, and she can't come out because she's got something wrong. Put somebody with her, like yourself, who can follow it, see here, and make her work. And then when she thinks that it's nearly all over, push another one in as quickly as you can. Make her work, until she tires up. And if you can make them, force her into group work, and force her to make her give a sitting, so she's having to get to the depth of it. So she's got to work and keep her going, you'll find that it will encourage her. That's what she needs at the present time. She needs very much to be made to work. With our two friends at the beginning there, they suddenly go, when I made her go forward onto there, there is this sort of, she needs